Good morning and welcome to our time of worship this morning at Clark Summit United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor John and it is good to be with you this morning as we gather for worship this morning. We are invited into this time of worship by a God who invites us into relationship with Him. No matter the experiences of our week, whether a time of joy or a time of struggle and trial, God welcomes us into this time of worship. So I would invite you to stand for our call to worship as we begin our time of worship this morning.
Come away from the valleys of misplaced loyalties. Come, seeking to meet the God of all creation. Come to praise God and give thanks. We believe God's steadfast love endures forever. We come together that our faith might be strengthened. We seek the strength to live all we profess. God's awesome deeds for our ancestors. Show that God's steadfast love continues with us. God continues to deliver us in times of distress. God's steadfast love endures forever. Please remain standing for our opening prayer. Gracious God, whose banquet table prepared for our enjoyment offers such the best that life can hold, grant us in these moments we spend together such a taste of your feast. We will be eager to every day meet you in prayer, meditation, and study of the scriptures, and be confident of finding you in our relationships and in all that we do, that our lives may honor you and bring joy to others. Amen. Our hymn today is Gather Us In. For those of you on our email list, it is included in the bulletin that was sent to you. For those of you in the sanctuary, please refrain from singing, but for those of you at home, please feel free to sing along.
Our fears and our dreamings brought here to you in the light of day.
Today's first scripture reading is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
I would invite us into our time with the children this morning. Have you ever gotten an invitation, maybe to go to a party? Yeah, a birthday party maybe, or another special event? Now, sometimes when you get an invitation, it'll say RSVP. Wonder what that means. That means that whoever is hosting the party wants you to send a reply to let them know that you're coming. Now, why am I talking about invitations? Jesus, in our scripture for today, talks about a father who is having a wedding banquet for his son. And he sends out invitations to all of the important people in his day. But when they send back their RSVP, they say, "We're not coming. We're too busy." So the father is very upset. And he invites other people to come. Other people who are both good and bad, anyone, in fact, is invited to come to his son's wedding feast. And so I want us, as we hear of that invitation that Jesus speaks about in our scripture for this morning, about Jesus' invitation to each of us. Jesus invites each of us into a relationship with him. That invitation of the Father is our Heavenly Father inviting us into life with him. Will you pray with me this morning? God, we give you thanks for your invitation into life with you in Jesus Christ. We pray, O God, that we might respond to your invitation to invite you into our heart and our life. We ask this all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I would invite us into our prayer time this morning. You'll see on the back of the messenger an updated prayer list for this morning. In particular, I'd like to invite you to be in prayer for Edith Kerber, who is in the hospital in Philadelphia, and also an update on Jerry Derrick, who was in the hospital last week. He has now returned home and is recovering at home. If there are others that you would like to include in our prayer list or others that are in need of prayer, you're invited to call the church office or also reach out to a member of our prayer team. I would invite us into a time of prayer this morning. Holy and loving God, as we gather on this day to worship you, we give you thanks for your presence. We pray, O God, as we gather for this time of worship here in the church building, or if we gather at home on the live stream, that your Holy Spirit might fill our hearts and minds as we gather for this time of prayer. We pray, O God, for your presence to surround us as it surrounds us each and every day, that as we lift our voices in worship of you today, that we might experience your presence in a real and powerful way. We'll hear in a few moments of your invitation to each of us, an invitation to the kingdom. We pray, O God, that you might stir in our hearts and our lives, that we might respond to your invitation not just in these moments of worship, but in each of the moments of our everyday life, that we might walk each moment as a disciple of Jesus. As we come before you in prayer, O God, we lift up to you each person represented on our prayer list today, and those that we name only in our hearts. We pray, O God, for those who are hospitalized, who are ill this day, who are recuperating. We pray, O God, for your touch of healing and of comfort to be upon each of these, your children. We pray, O God, for those families that grieve this day, for the over 200,000 families that grieve those who have been lost to COVID-19, and to those others who grieve this day. We pray, O God, that you would surround them with your peace, and remind them of the hope that we have in you of eternal life. We pray also for those out west who continue to deal with the ravages of wildfires, for families, communities that have been devastated and lost everything because of these fires. We also pray for the firefighters and others who place their lives on the line to seek to contain these fires. We pray, O God, that you might move in a real and powerful way. We pray also for those in the Gulf Coast who are experiencing the effects of Hurricane Delta. We pray, O God, that you would keep each of your children safe. For those whose homes and property is destroyed, for those who are displaced, O God, we pray that you would surround them with your presence. We pray also, O God, for those in our community, in our circles, in our nation, and in our world who continue to be affected by this pandemic. We pray, O God, for your healing presence to be upon each person who has been infected. We pray for those who continue to be on the front lines, in our hospitals, in our schools, in our communities. We pray for families who grieve because of the loss of a loved one. We pray also for those in pharmaceutical companies, at research laboratories, who are seeking treatments and a cure for this virus. We pray, O God, that you would give them wisdom and strength, that they might find suitable treatments and a vaccine, O God. And finally, O God, we lift up to you ourselves. For each person who is gathered here in this place this morning, for those who are gathering digitally on our live stream, O God, we pray that you would move in each of our hearts to call us to deeper faithfulness with you, to call us to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, that our lives might be a witness of your love, your grace, and your forgiveness in our world. We ask this all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, Olivia and Emily, for sharing your gift of music with us this morning. Our scripture for this morning comes from Matthew chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves and mistreated them and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to the slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him out into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. I want you to imagine for a moment a wedding celebration. Maybe a wedding that you were to recently, and with all that's been going on, maybe recently as a year or two ago. Maybe even your own wedding, as you think of the celebration, the pomp and circumstance of the occasion. In recent memory, we have had two royal weddings, the first of Prince William and Kate Middleton, and also of most recently of Prince Harry and Meghan Markle. To say that these weddings were over the top is perhaps an understatement. The ceremony, the lavishness of these occasions was on full display for the world as many of us watched. Now imagine a few years ago, before one of these weddings, if in your mail you found an invitation to one of these royal weddings. What an honor! What a privilege! Unfortunately, I don't think any of us got such an invitation, because there weren't many people, I imagine, that said no to such an invitation. This is the sort of extravagance that Jesus speaks about when he speaks in this parable of the wedding banquet. Now, Jesus has repeatedly spoke of this image of a wedding banquet to describe the kingdom of God. For those hearers in Jesus' day, the wedding event would be no less of a ceremony of an event than it is today. In the ancient world, a family's honor was on full display for multiple days as they feasted and celebrated the wedding. Jesus even ups the ante here when he describes that this just isn't any wedding. This is the wedding for the king's son. It would be an occasion for extravagance, where the normal limits of budgets and all of that would be thrown out the window. However, Jesus adds some plot twists as he tells this particular parable. We hear first of those guests that are invited. Guests of importance, those who are important people in the day, probably a list of the who's who of their time. But when the appointed day comes, the day of the wedding banquet, well, they don't show up. They're too busy. And then to add injury to insult, they insult those who have come to offer the invitation. The king is shocked that they would not come to partake and celebrate in this special occasion. And a day that should have been marked by joy and celebration is instead marked by destruction, as the king responds. Now, when we read up until this point in Jesus' parable, we may say, well, the king might as well have just scrapped the whole event. But he didn't. Instead, he tells his slaves to go out and invite everyone, anyone, most especially to welcome even those who are unwelcomeable. And just as the wedding party is filling up, the banquet hall is filling up, Jesus adds yet another speed bump into the parable. One of those guests who has come in off the street at the invitation of those who were sent out isn't wearing the proper attire for the occasion. Now, when we hear of this, we could make all sorts of excuses for this person. Well, how would he have known what to wear? How would he have been properly attired? He was just invited in off the street. But somehow this doesn't seem to be the case in the way that Jesus tells this parable. When questioned about not being properly attired, the guest simply gives no response at all, at which point he is thrown out of the banquet. All right, Jesus, what are we to do with this parable? I think here that Jesus speaks about the kingdom, about the invitation to participate in the kingdom. Notice the banquet is filled with all sorts of people, but it's filled with those who have dropped everything to respond to the invitation the king has offered. Whether we are new in our faith or have been a lifelong member of this congregation, we should never lose sight of the radical invitation that Jesus offers to each of us. If we lose the sense of the radical invitation that Jesus gives, we've taken God's grace for granted. This parable reminds us that none of us are entitled to a place in the kingdom of God. The banquet is filled with all sorts of people, but there's no quality control. Anyone and everyone is invited to come and to join that celebration. Many human institutions, however, have restrictions, have limitations on who can attend. This past week, I looked up some statistics on the application acceptance rate at my alma mater, Yale University. Last year, they received just over 35,000 applications, and they accepted 2,304 students. That's a 6.5% acceptance rate, placing them somewhere around fifth as the most selective college in the nation. Unlike our parable today, Yale doesn't say, "Come all you who are burdened and heavy laden, come and study with us." No, there are stringent admission criteria. To my knowledge, there are few, if any, institutions or organizations where everybody and anybody can come freely and be a part. However, this is exactly what Jesus does when he invites us to be a part of the kingdom. Jesus invites anybody who shows up. This is the good news of Jesus. As Paul says it, while we were still sinning, Christ died for us. This is the good news of Jesus, that the wages of our sin should be death, but the free gift of God is eternal life. This is God's invitation to each of us, an invitation of love. For God so loved the world that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. As guests at God's banquet, we're not entitled to just some special privileges or a good dinner, but we are called to be citizens of the kingdom. And the mark, the garment of that, is a transformed life, a life that follows in the footsteps of Jesus. Our life as followers of Jesus isn't just about that invitation, but also that journey of faith, of coming into the banquet and being part of the work that God is doing. We must put on the appropriate attire of faith. But the invitation to the banquet into the kingdom of God doesn't stop when we enter. Remember the man who fails to be properly attired for the banquet. There's more to our relationship with God than just saying yes to God's invitation. Jesus doesn't call us just to say yes and then sit back and feel safe and comfortable. But Jesus calls us to a life as a disciple of Jesus, to the difficult road of taking up our cross each day to follow him. Life as a disciple of Jesus isn't about what we're entitled to, but about God's invitation to each of us, to each of God's children, each person gathered here, each person watching, and even those people that would never, ever set foot in a church building. But God invites each of us to come to the feast, to allow God to transform our life, to transform our heart. And so our attitude in response to such an invitation should be gratitude for God's gift to us in Jesus Christ. A gift that we can't earn, an invitation that is freely given to each of us. And so the best response to the invitation of God is to run breathlessly into the banquet hall, dressed for the occasion, and wondering, how in the world did we make the guest list? Will you pray with me? God, we give you thanks for your invitation to each of us. An invitation that seems almost scandalous when we consider that you invite each of us, broken and not deserving of such a gift, but yet you invite each of us to join your kingdom, to be a disciple of Jesus, to grow in our walk with you, and to be in relationship with you, O God. We give you thanks for your invitation of grace and for our opportunity to respond. We pray, O God, that each of us might respond to your invitation to live a life as a disciple of Jesus, to offer ourselves entirely to you, to be used by you to building your kingdom. This we ask in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Today we celebrate the confirmation of Olivia and Maeve. Confirmation is a sacred celebration of commitment and a day of celebration in our church. Confirmation is not a sacrament in the United Methodist Church, but an important marker in our journey of faith. At our baptism, we are initiated into the new covenant in Jesus Christ and into membership into the church universal. Often in our tradition, that happens when we are very young, perhaps even an infant. Confirmation is then an opportunity to respond to God's grace already at work in our lives, already acknowledged in our baptism, and to promise to live as a person of faith. Confirmation is also a public profession of our acceptance of the grace that we receive in Jesus Christ, and of our profession of faith that Jesus is our Lord and Savior. Confirmation also involves the local congregation here, in which the congregation, you all, recommit yourselves to living a life after the example of Jesus. And so we celebrate with Olivia and Maeve today. We celebrate their commitment to live as faithful disciples of Jesus and also recommit ourselves to living faithfully as disciples of Jesus. I would invite Olivia and Maeve to come forward. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift, offered to us without price. Through confirmation, we renew the covenant declared at our baptism, acknowledging what God is doing for us and affirming our commitment to Christ's holy church. on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin?
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves?
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord, in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all nations, ages, and races?
I do.
According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world?
I will.
And do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life, and include these young women now before you in your care? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them, that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection, and to make disciples of all nations. Declare God's works to the nations, his glory among all the people. Pour out your Holy Spirit and bless the gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness through their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. Olivia, Maeve, remember your baptism and be thankful. Olivia and Maeve, the Holy Spirit work within you that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. As a member of Christ's universal church, will you be loyal to Christ through the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? As a member of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness?
I will.
Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love, as members together with you in the body of Christ,
and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you in the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Amen. We welcome both Olivia and Maeve as members of this congregation and as God's children today. I would invite you to stand for our hymn, Sanctuary. Invite you to be seated as our invitation to giving this morning. We'll hear an update from the mission team, and so Fred, I would invite you to share with us an update.
Good morning. It's been quite a while since I had the opportunity to speak with you guys considering these crazy times. For those of you at home watching and in church, my name is Fred Hawkins. I'm a member of the mission team here at Clark Summit United Methodist Church, and I've been asked to brief you guys on what's been going on. In June, we completed our spring Adopt-a-Highway obligation. In July, we provided a bag meal to the Keystone Mission. In August, we had our first Zoom meeting since COVID in March, and we discussed the purchasing of a hot water heater for a family in need here in our church. We also discussed the Adopt-a-Highway, the AED installation, prison ministry, the food pantry, the Keystone Mission, and the possibility of having another church has left the building. In September, we did complete our fall Adopt-a-Highway obligation, and we also installed the AEDs. The AEDs were installed by myself, Howard, and Louise. Coming up in October, although it's going to look very different, we're going to try to have a mini church has left the building on the 24th with a rain date on the 25th. So we're seeking ideas. Is there somebody in need, a neighbor, someone who needs some fall cleanup or some minor repairs? Please send the ideas over to the church office so we can organize them and address it accordingly. We're also going to provide a bag meal to the Keystone Mission. This meal will include macaroni salad, beans, sandwiches, brownies, and potato chips. This generous effort is being provided by the Louise Brennan family. Thank you for your generosity. In the future, we're looking at reaching out to the schools, Abington Heights, Lackawanna Trail, in Lakeland, to assess their needs in this unique time and to discuss them at the meeting to see how we can address them. We're also discussing ways to bring the church into the community through programs called the Fresh Expressions and exploring what opportunities that might provide Clark Summit United Methodist for reaching more people. We've discussed exploring the possibility of prison ministry and how that would look for here at the church. We continue to collect noisy change. We have not designated a purpose for that money as far as certain acts, but we're open to ideas, so please send any suggestions over and we'll keep you guys in the loop as far as what we're going to do and the missions we're going to complete. Yoga for a Cause is back in the church now that the weather is colder. They are taking all precautions and sanitizing accordingly, so we're glad to have them back. In the future, we're going to revisit the golf tournament that we had started planning right when COVID hit, and we had to cancel, unfortunately, but we will revisit that. We're also going to be looking at another Bring a Friend Sunday, which was very successful, where everybody brought somebody into the church and we had a luncheon afterwards. And we're also going to entertain the idea of an adult kickball tournament, which originally was for kids, but the adults seem to be more interested. Our next meeting is scheduled for 7 p.m. on October 20th via Zoom. We're inviting everybody and anybody. Please get in touch with Pastor so we can put you on the email list. The more people we have, the better off we are and the more missions we can complete. So please feel free to voice your suggestions and join the team. Thank you and God bless.
Thank you, Fred, for sharing those updates. And also as a reminder for the activities and missions that the mission team is looking to help our church be involved in, you don't have to be a member of the mission team to take part in those activities. And in particular, I'll highlight again, the church has left the building. If there are projects that you know of or individuals that are in need of some outdoor work or some minor repairs, please be in touch as we're putting that together for later in the month. As we offer our gifts today, we are called to be the hands and feet of Christ. And your regular intentional giving is vital to our mission and ministry here as Clark Summit United Methodist Church, as we seek to be a witness for Christ here in our community and throughout the world. I would invite you to stand for the doxology. Please join me in the offertory prayer. May our offerings help to prepare many to feast at your banquet table. May our generosity reflect the amazing abundance you entrust to our care. As we find joy in giving, may others be inspired to give their best, and may all of us realize your peace, dwelling within and among us as we serve in Christ's name. Amen. Our closing hymn for this morning, I Want to Walk as a Child of Light. As our time of worship draws to a close this morning, I would invite you to take a few moments to look at the messenger for some updates and announcements for the week. The Bible study and discipleship group will continue to meet on Monday and Wednesday evenings, respectively. As Fred shared, the mission team meeting is coming up on October 20th, If you're interested in taking a part in that, please let me know and we'll get you connected for that link. Also, you'll see on the screen and also in the messenger an announcement about a Connect card. This is an opportunity you can share a little bit of information about yourself if you're visiting with us or if you're online joining us. Also, if you have a prayer request, this is another opportunity which you can share a prayer request with myself or the prayer team. Hear now these words of benediction. As we go this morning, God invites us to his wedding feast, to the feast of his kingdom. Doesn't matter who we are, what we've done, what we've failed to do, Christ invites us. And so my prayer is that we might respond to that invitation to live as Christ's people. Let us go with the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.